Tonight we're back to camping stories. I'm planning on going camping soon, so hopefully I don't add to the list. I've noticed recently that YouTube hasn't been recommending the videos as much as usual. If you like this channel and want to help support me, please like the video and leave a comment and make sure you're subscribed. It really helps. Thank you to all of you who keep coming back. Before we begin, if you think you might fall asleep, please introduce yourself in the comments. Please also like the video and subscribe if you haven't already. I'm always interested in knowing what country everyone is from, so let us know in the comments and share what time it is where you are. Thank you once more for joining me. Get cozy, grab a glass of water, turn the lights off, and make sure you've locked your door. Don't forget to say hello in the comments. It's time to close your eyes. This all went down during the spring break of my junior year of high school. My school was in a pretty small Iowa town, with a district spanning several smaller hamlets. During the summer of 2014, a few friends of mine put together a film club that would make short films and compete in national film festivals against other schools. We were a pretty small group, and I found it kind of difficult to get together for any actual filming until spring break of 2015, when we made plans for a little excursion. Four of us ended up going on the trip, myself and three members of the club, let's call them Jake, Bill, and Kyle. We ended up choosing to go camping at Mossy Glen Hollow, a supposedly haunted state park in northeastern Iowa. Since the 1850s, there have been several murders and suicides at Mossy Glen, including a few decapitations and a hired hitman in the 1930s. Being the edgy teens that we jumped at the chance to go hiking and camping somewhere like that. It was within 15 minutes of a small town as well, so stocking up on food wouldn't be that big of an issue either. So, all lights green, we loaded up two of our sedans, programmed the GPS, and off we went for a spring break camping in some haunted woods. After the first hour and a half on the road, a few red flags began to fly. After the last large town before getting away into the boondocks, my phone's data signal cut out, and the GPS randomly changed directions on us. Since none of us had any idea where the hell we were at, or where Mossy Glen was supposed to be, we didn't have much choice but to blindly follow the new route. Once we were firmly in the middle of nowhere, our GPS took us off the paved highways and onto gravel roads. At this point, you typically would see the usual brown Iowa DNR signs designating that you were near a state park, but there were none. There weren't even any tree clumps to indicate that you were near some sort of forest. Another 10 minutes or so into the drive, and the gravel road soon turns into a dirt road, then a low maintenance road, then a Class B minimum maintenance road. With Iowa's dedication to road preservation, this basically means that somebody probably came by and took a peek in the 90s and then promptly forgot about its existence. As we came around the last hilly bend that the GPS shows on our route, we see a farmhouse with a large machine shed, with no lights or activity around either, and no cars in the driveway. A bit weirded out that a house would be right next to a state park, we slow down and keep rolling. To our dismay, however, the road dissolves into a mess of washed tractor tire gouges from last fall's harvest. We stop the cars as far down as we can pass without getting hung up on a frozen rut and unpack some of our equipment. The road gradually narrows, snakes down the middle of a field, and turns down into a small but very thick clump of woods at the bottom of a wide ravine. We get out and hike down the gradually steepening slope and take in the scenery. At first, everything looks like a pretty damn cool set to a film. There are several limestone outcrops hanging off the hillside, a footpath with some picturesque tree overhang, and even a few birds out that made an unseasonal return from wintering down south. We can all hear some water running but can't identify a source from the trail. Looking off in any direction, all we could see was a seemingly endless sea of trees. At the bottom of the hill was a small pond in the middle of a grassy clearing, with a fence. As we approached the fence, we noticed a sign, private property. Keep out. Bill checks his watch and realizes that it's almost time for dinner, so we trek back to our vehicles and hook up the GPS. The nearest town over was a little place called Edgewood that had several diners and a gas station to load up on supplies for the week. We brought some canned food, but not much beyond that. As we got to town, we realized that Edgewood was a lot smaller than we expected, less than 900 people, it would turn out. Everyone knows everyone in these small towns, so we got several weird looks when four strangers rolled up with plates from the other side of the state. Kyle asked the cashier and a few people at the gas station about Mossy Glen Hollow and why the only route was through some dude's field on a busted outdoor road. To our surprise, nobody had even heard of a place called Mossy Glen, nor could they figure out why the hell four high schoolers suddenly rolled into town looking for the place. We shrugged it off as just a few crazy locals and took back down the dirt trail. As we rounded the corner back near the farmhouse, we noticed that all the lights were still off and nobody seemed to be home. I suggested that we leave some sort of note on the house door that we were going to be parking on the side of the road near their place, just to be safe. It was starting to get late in the day, and being this far out in the country, it wouldn't be unheard of to come face to face with a shotgun when the homeowners found our cars. Since the road was impassable from that point on anyway, parking there wouldn't realistically block anybody off the road and would still technically be on public land. We hiked back down the wooded trail and started scouting for a place to set up camp for the night, making sure to be on the public side of the fence pond area. We discovered that the sea of trees that we saw earlier was actually quite a bit thinner when seen from below. In fact, the dirt path led to a decently sized clearing with a creek and small waterfall cutting through the limestone deposits. None of us could believe that we had missed such a thing a few hours earlier. When Bill comes to the realization, he disappeared around the corner back into the trees and emerges at the top of the trail a few minutes later. Though we could plainly see him, the trees lined up just right so that he could not see anything beyond the rocks below the path ledge. Continuing further up the creek, we noticed that there are conveniently placed rocks about the perfect distance apart to step over without disturbing the water or surrounding rocks. One could walk almost silently down the creek while the sound of the water masked the steps. Not thinking much of it, we take some pictures of the large moss-covered boulders all around and get some pretty nice scenic shots. We find a place to make camp, and everything is going great until we approach the waterfall. Just before the waterfall, set a clearing without any large boulders or rocks, and an odd arrangement of logs. One set horizontal, supported at each end by two piles of rocks. There was a crude stone circle with a pile of burnt logs inside, a fire pit with a bench. Although a bit surprised at first, we shrugged it off as some weekend project that the people of the house put together. After all, with such a cool place just a short walk from home, why not? I have a similar fire pit set up at home, so I'm not too concerned. Hey, what the hell is this? Kyle yells from a boulder a few yards ahead. There was an orange beanie, a single gardening glove, an empty can of beer, and a stick of deodorant that had seen some serious wear. Looking closer at the beer can, we realized that it must have been opened fairly recently. Foam is still fresh in the bottom of the can, and it still had a fumey smell. Bewildered by what the hell we just found, Jake starts looking around the side of the boulders upstream of the items. There's a cave over here, he shouts back to us. Later, he told us that the cave was large enough to comfortably fit a person inside, and, more disturbingly, he saw some red fabric inside as well. Before he can get a good look around, Kyle calls all three of us back over to him with a sense of urgency. He speaks very quietly to us and indicates that we shouldn't shout back. Shampoo, he whispers, pointing urgently down at his feet. Sure enough, in the mud and the leaves, there's a blue bottle of Suave shampoo right next to the creek. At this point, we're all adequately freaked out and ready to call our little soiree quits. Bill remains pretty sure that this is just junk left behind by the people of the house after a weekend of a few too many drinks, but things just didn't add up to me. There's one detail that I've been leaving out up to this point. The day before, this part of Iowa caught some heavy rain, which contributed to the mud situation on the road and on the trail. With the combination of wind and rain, the items on the rocks would have shown some signs of being wet, if not been displaced entirely. Also, the air was pretty cold, as it is every year around this time, not getting above the mid-40s for the whole week. Then, everything starts to click for me. Whoever drank the beer and left the shampoo, hat, glove, and deodorant must have done so this morning. The fire pit also had fresh char marks on the rocks, and the wood had not been lit for a while, meaning that it must have been lit last night at the earliest. The small cave would have provided enough shelter from the rain to stay dry. With the freezing temps all throughout the day, whoever was using shampoo out here must have had little other choice to do so. If it was the homeowners, they would have had to be serious masochists, debating the shallow freezing Rocky Creek rather than at home. If it wasn't them, then we likely weren't alone right now. Whoever left these things out left in a hurry, and if they were here 4 hours ago, they would have been able to see us on the trail cliff long before we even knew they were down here. Remembering the arrangement of rocks on the stream, they could have even been leaving their camp just as we were coming down the dirt trail. As I processed this, I started to look around at my surroundings and realized that the small area was bordered by the thick trees on the trail side, several sets of huge boulders on the pond side, and limestone cliffs everywhere else. Due to the tree, rock, and hill cover, you could light a fire in the pit at night, and nobody around would ever know. If you were wearing brown or green, you could easily see down from the rocks on top to the camp below while blending in with the trees above. Coming to these realizations, I noticed something else, something more sinister. The birds and small animals that we previously heard were now quiet. Aside from the soft babble of the creek, the entire place was completely silent. As I started to explain this to the rest of the group, I saw the wheels turning in their heads as well. Jake starts to head back to the small cave when something rustling up on the limestone ridgeline catches our attention. Something large was shifting around up there, something that apparently didn't want Jake to see what was in the cave. We all look up, and whatever made the noise starts shuffling down the ridge toward the makeshift camp. Because of the high cliff, the only way down to us would be by going all the way back down to the pond and then doubling back up the stream. Realizing this almost by ourselves, and how open we were, we booked it back up the stream, up the dirt path, across the field, and back to our cars. On the drive back to Edgewood, we all tried to process what just happened. I take a look at the satellite map, and the only really accessible way to the cliff where we heard the noise would be to walk up there from the pond. It was too craggy to approach from the adjacent field to the east. Whatever made that noise would have had to be large too, and a deer getting up there wouldn't necessarily be out of the question. It would have had some incredible timing to have started moving just as Jake started looking at the cave and whatever red fabric was inside. Kyle found a report of an escaped convict from a local prison a few weeks ago and was convinced that it was his camp that we found, but we were all doubtful at best of this idea. To satisfy his concerns, we agreed to report the strange things we found to the police anonymously, since we all wanted to really get home at this point. None of us followed up on them, and I doubt anything came out of it. A small town police department gets a report of strange sightings from some stranger, and the same day, some high schoolers roll up and park outside a farmer's house for a few hours. Doesn't exactly spell high threat criminal activity to me. Still, things just don't seem to add up. Whoever came running down that cliff, if indeed it was a who, wanted to keep whatever was inside the cave hidden. But not enough to actually fight some teenagers. We figured he just wanted to scare us off since the noises seemed to stop once we reached the dirt path. I thought it odd that someone living out in the woods, with something seemingly to hide, would set up shop in a state park. That is until I checked my GPS again. That little route that it took us on was an old entrance to the park that had been cut off by the purchase of the lake area. The map records used for Google's navigation were updated, and we couldn't see that. The place we were at was still public land, for sure, but not quite what we pictured. I would like to state that this story might read like the plot of a 1980s horror movie and is going to be very long. However, this entire story is true. If not for being 5 miles from cell reception and the way the story ends, there would be a police report for verification. I tried to camp with my buddy twice a month, now that I have a vehicle that can be trusted to get me to some of the more remote areas of our state. We planned a camping trip for the past weekend. We chose a fairly remote location that we'd been to the previous weekend. The previous weekend, we were the only people we'd seen within 1 mile of our camp spot. Friday night, we got there and set up. This story takes place Saturday night. It's about 9 p.m., so the sun is long gone and the moon hasn't quite risen yet. It's pitch black out, other than when our fire lights up. Suddenly, we hear a man screaming. We listen intently, silently sharing an anxious look. At first, we were hoping it was someone drunk and having a little too much fun, but it quickly becomes obvious this isn't fun party screaming. It isn't even like he's hurt. It sounds full of despair, anger, and anguish. I'm going to take a moment to remind you that this is 9 p.m., pitch black night in the middle of nowhere, 5 miles from the nearest cell phone signal. We hadn't seen anyone in hours. The screaming continues for what felt like hours, but was probably about 5 solid minutes. We had no idea what to make of it and started feeling extremely paranoid. We gathered up anything remotely close to a weapon and tried to come up with explanations for the screaming while keeping our eyes on the forest around us. After about 10 to 15 minutes of fear-induced paranoia, I nearly fell out of my seat as I watched a flashlight and lantern slowly enter our camp. I greeted the stranger with a basic "how's it going?" before he was even lit up by the fire. He responded quickly but flatly by asking if we could do him a favor. "That depends on the favor," my buddy and I said in unison, obviously tense, holding our weapons close to us. The stranger proceeded to ask if he could hang out for a second by the fire. Given that there were two of us, and only one of him, plus our myriad of weapons gathered from around the camp to within our arm's reach, we decided to agree and let him hang out. After a short second of awkward silence, I asked him what the hell was going on. He proceeds to tell us that he was camping down the trail with his buddy and that his buddy had snapped and tried to kill him. "Wait, what?" I said before the thought even finished processing in my head. "Is that the screaming we heard earlier?" The man slowly nods, staring blankly into the fire, and begins his story. "We were just hanging out. We came up earlier today and my buddy just freaked out. He started screaming and screaming and just wouldn't stop. Then he attacked me. He lunged at me, and I told him to just back off and chill. Well, he kept coming after me and it started getting pretty violent, and I'm pretty sure he was going to kill me. So, I grabbed my car keys, the light, and I ran. I don't know what to do. He chased me when I ran, and I don't know what to do. We don't have firearms or anything, we only have a hatchet." My buddy and I looked at each other for a second, completely astonished, then something horrible dawned on me. "Wait, he chased you? Like, he's on his way here?" The man just slowly nods in reply, and right on cue, like some terrible horror movie come to life, we hear screaming from maybe 30 to 40 feet from our camp, down on the main trail. "I just want to talk," is what we heard him screaming. I'd never in my life heard a man scream like this. I'd never heard anything like it. It was a brutal scream that was shrill to the ears, yet deep in pitch, the sound of someone gone completely mad. and the way he said the stranger's name would switch erratically from long and melodic to short punches of sound. We killed our lights, became silent, and listened. By some miracle, the madman did not notice our camp and continued walking down the trail, screaming the whole way. We ended up chatting with this scary guy for hours, listening to the screaming getting further and further away. We come to find out they had taken 4.5 to 5 grams of mushrooms each, and Gary's buddy was a co-worker of his and was fine for 3 hours, then suddenly snapped. It seemed as though he thought he could kill Gary and steal his good trip. We hear the screamings getting further and further for over 2 hours. By this time, it's 11 p.m., the moon is starting to come out, and it's below 30 degrees Fahrenheit. He had no jacket or flashlight, according to Gary. My buddy and I are way too drunk to drive out of camp to get cell service, as it was snowy and icy and required 2 to 3 miles of highway driving after getting off the trail. Gary was still lightly feeling the effects of mushrooms, so he couldn't drive back either. We had to make the decision to let the guy wander, hoping he sobered up and could find his way back. And he did, right into our camp. We hear yelling after about an hour of no screams, maybe 30 to 50 feet from camp again. "Hey, help, please help me." We tell Gary to hide, just in case, and we greet the man, with me carrying my 12-gauge shotgun, holstered, my buddy carrying his rifle, and also with our flashlights on their brightest settings in his face. He was about 6 feet 2 inches and approximately 300 pounds. We talked to him, decided he was calm enough to talk with, and walked him back to his camp. He seemed really remorseful, said he blacked out and didn't remember anything, then he had a falling out with his buddy. We escorted him back to his camp down the trail, returned, and told Gary that he seemed cool, and if anything else happens to scream and come running, we would come out and help him out. It ended up being a happy ending. We made friends with Gary, and I got his phone number to make sure the next day that he got back into town safely, back to his wife and kid. And we're actually planning on a camping trip with him soon. But the other guy, who wandered screaming like a deranged maniac in the forest, potentially wielding a hatchet to murder his friend, was not invited. To understand my story, you need to know a bit about trespassing laws in our country. We don't have any. As long as you are respectful and non-destructive, you can walk over any hills you like, and in my case, camp on any beach of your choosing. So long as you leave the area as you found it. I used to love camping as a child. Our family would go multiple times a year with a large group of my parents' friends and their kids. On average, there were maybe 10 of us at a time, which was a bit of a logistical challenge since we always headed out to this one really remote beach on the coast. Actually, we weren't the only ones. There were always yachts bobbing just off the shore with people in them, and other campers lining up the beach. Most of them also had children or teenagers, so it wasn't a wild party scene. It was very much an informal family holiday spot. There was even a small building with toilets and showers installed nearby, even though this was the middle of nowhere. I guess the local council must have figured it out, then got sick of people peeing behind bushes. We took a trip up in spring 2011. I remember this because I got my dog in winter 2010, after picking her out that November. I got her from the shelter as a birthday gift to myself, since I paid her adoption fee. She will be very important to the story later on. Let me tell you a little about Parmesan. Parmesan came to me as a 6-month-old puppy who had been rescued from a dog-fighting situation. We're not entirely sure what breed she is, but my best guess is a Lurcher-Staffy mix. She is a wonderfully well-tempered dog with people and most dogs, but you absolutely do not threaten her. By the time of this camping trip, I had Parmesan for a few months. She'd never come camping with us before, but as far as my family is concerned, dogs go on camping trips, so we all piled into the car, and she came with us. Unusually, none of the family friends could make it, so it was only me, my sister, my dad, and my mom. I didn't mind. I wasn't that attached to the other kids. I'd rather play with my dog, and I'd still have my sister. The drive took the best part of 6 hours, and because we left a bit later than normal, although I don't remember why, we arrived at sunset, not a good time to be building a tent. But we expected to arrive to other campers already set up, the beach illuminated by campfires. The beach was empty. In spite of this, my parents started taking stuff out and trying to build the tent. They asked us to fetch some of the lighter bags from the boot of the car while they sat, pointing a flashlight at the sand to see properly. I rolled down the window of the car for Parmesan before getting out. It was pretty hot for that time of year, and I wanted her to have air. I always got to be looking out for my furry little homie. As we fumbled about in the dark on a beach in the middle of nowhere, it was pretty spooky. The one road that led to this beach was circular and had a bridge over the water, meaning you could basically circle around the beach like a big O shape if you felt like it. I wasn't really paying any attention to the road. I was complaining I was tired, as kids do. But my mom was. After maybe 15 minutes of my dad trying to nail the tent into the sand, my mom asked him if he had seen the car drive around. It's been a few times. My dad kind of shrugged her off. He's sort of like that. I don't know if he said anything back to her, but after a few more minutes, a car pulled up next to ours on the road, and someone got out. It was maybe 15 or 20 feet from the cars to where we were, and the light was pretty low except for the torches. We weren't expecting to see anyone else out here at this point, and I think my mom said it must be security. I don't know why a random beach would have security, and I think what she meant was the Wildlife Trust or something, as they do occasionally come down to do their work. The guy was walking pretty unevenly. He must have been drunk or high because he had that stagger to him. There was absolutely no way this guy was sober. Cool, a junkie. Not an unusual find, but it's rare to see them in the wild. As he walked into the flashlight range, we realized he was carrying a large knife, maybe 15 inches, although I was small at the time, so maybe my sense of scale was off. I don't like my dad, but credit to him, once he saw this, he got up immediately, holding onto the camping mallet, and put us all behind him. The man began to shout wildly at us that we can't camp here, and he was just letting us know. My dad tried to initially be a bit friendly with the guy and told him that was fine, we'd leave, but this didn't work. He kept coming closer to us, so my dad started shouting, and the man kept shouting back. My sister and I were crying. I remember shaking. I was utterly terrified, as I'm sure anyone would be in that situation. It really did seem like this guy and my dad were going to fight, and I'm going to be honest, I didn't fancy my dad's chances. While it's grim to consider, I'm absolutely convinced he would have killed my dad and possibly us as well once he was done, as I don't think my mother would have had the common sense to run with us. I love her, but she's always put her relationship with my dad above us. This isn't how it went down. From the black, like a wolf descending on its prey, took us all by surprise, most of all the man with the knife. In that moment, Parmesan was the apex predator, large canines representing nature. She got him good by the arm and clamped down hard, ripping his jacket and shredding the skin underneath. He dropped the knife as it had been in the arm she latched onto. He kicked her, he punched her, and eventually got her off. He grabbed the knife from the sand and ran back to his car and drove off. Parmesan didn't follow him. She stayed with us, covered in blood. As quickly as we could, we gathered our things and all got back in the car, all pretty shook up by the incident. I looked Parmi over, she was okay, but the car's window was much more open than I left it. We think what had happened was when the shouting started, she must have put a paw upon the gap I'd left for her, as it was an old car and had the manual windows, not an electric button. We think she must have been able to hit it with her paws to force it down enough to squeeze out. This is not the end of my story. We were all pretty scared, and since we had a dog with us, we couldn't book into a hotel for the night. My parents decided to just drive home so we could all feel safe, but first, we had to drive into the nearest town for petrol as they were kind of low. I spent the time trying to clean Parmesan up a little. I'd always loved dogs, but what she just done for me blew my mind. As we drove into town, we came across a gas station, but it looked closed. My dad drove up closer and stuck his head out of the window to get a better look at the sign. My mom asked him what on earth he was doing, and he told her he was trying to see when it opens. My heart sank. Parked in the corner behind a van, so we didn't see him at first, was the man with the knife. He was sitting on the bonnet of his car, using some tissue paper to clean up his arm. It looked pretty bad. Without stopping to refuel or look anywhere else in town, my dad drove right out of there. He decided to go to the next town over, but this was too remote. The next town over was 60 miles away. He didn't have that much petrol. We realized as we began driving, we were going to break down. "That's fine," Dad said. "We had a cover. They'd come to his home, or at least somewhere acceptable for the night, better than staying in the last town." After driving for maybe 5 minutes, lights flashed from behind. Another car. The same car the man had been driving. It was him, following us. He must have realized we were low on petrol. The next half hour was one of the worst half hours of my life. I had a complete and utter breakdown, as did everyone really. I could tell my parents were trying to keep it under wraps so it wouldn't upset us, but we weren't really little kids. We were both double digits. We knew how dangerous this situation was. Dad turned off the radio to conserve petrol, and the man followed us for 55 miles before he peeled away onto another road. Our fuel meter was on the big red E for empty for the last 10 miles. We were driving on fumes. I don't really believe in God, but if he does exist, that was definitely one of his miracles. Once we got there, we refilled to a full tank before driving the rest of the way home. My sister and I slept in the car after that. I only woke up once we made it all the way home, just grateful nothing worse had happened than that. After getting some sleep, my mom phoned the non-emergency line for the police and reported what had happened, and they never got back to her after that. But apparently, the woman she spoke to said they may wish to in the future, as he matched the description of a suspect wanted in relation to a murder charge. No idea if he actually was that guy or just a random psycho. As I said, they never got back to her. So what's the takeaway then, other than avoiding the crazy man on the beach? Well, for me, it's that I love Parmesan. She's still with us now, old as the hills and twice as grizzled as one of my mom's friends likes to joke. I don't know why she did what she did that day, but I couldn't tell you what her thought process was. What I do know is that this poor puppy was born into an environment where they abused and neglected her, only to be rescued and taken shelter to where her mother and siblings all found homes before her. Despite how badly people had treated her, when I took her home, she forgave but never forgot. I think the saying is, I never trust a person who doesn't like a dog, but I always trust a dog when they don't like a person. They have a very good understanding of human body language, and I think she must have understood how much danger we were in. I paid £78 for Parmesan's adoption fee, which is a lot when you're a kid, but it chills me to my bones knowing if I hadn't been so insistent on a dog, I might have been killed.